You're listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network, now the largest new media platform on the web, and your number one source for after-show entertainment. Very good,
The AfterBuzz Studios in Los Angeles, California. Presented by Maria Menounos and streaming live thanks to Akamai Technologies. This is AfterBuzz TV's The Challenge After Show. We'll break down tonight's episode and get you all the latest news and gossip. And now, another post-game wrap-up show for your favorite TV show. It's AfterBuzz TV's The Challenge After Show.
Swaggy.
Like that, just like that, Roxy. Give me the eyes.
Rhythm is a dancer. I need a companion. Girl,
wait,
I
what
guess
is
that
this?
Search to the song, Nicolette.
Body like the summer. Fucking like no other.
Yo, what up, guys? It's your boy DJ Jesse Janedy here in studio for MTV's The Challenge Free Agent. If you guys want to know, because you guys keep asking what the songs are at the beginning, that is Jeremiah Don't Know.
Can you remind me that at the end?
I will.
Jeremiah
Don't Know.
Don't Know.
Here in studio, we have the lovely Nicolette Sensei Gaona.
Hello.
Bam.
Hello, everyone. Hello.
This is Good Morning America.
Sure the fuck is.
She's like.
Yeah, exactly.
The Mark Long.
Bam.
And Roxy Striar.
Hi, guys.
Crowd goes wild.
In the booth, we got the one and only Phil Svitek. And Phil's going to be patching us in with the one, the only, Sir Johnny Bananas very shortly. But first, let's
He was
start.
Very excited to call in.
I'm excited to hear
We had I had Roxy believing he was going home tonight.
Yeah. You absolutely did not.
She was on pins
you
and needles, so
bit.
Was
no,
Sensei
was.
Don't Play.
Okay, the I second I knew he was willing to I call was. In, and I'm going to say this, I'm going to ask him this question. If he had lost tonight, I don't think he would have called in. I'm going to ask
this
him.
This was my trick. I said if he lost, he would not come in studio. But if he won, he'd probably want to come in studio. He's just, the traffic was too bad, so he's calling in.
We've been doing
I did a
this?
Bait and switch.
Uh-uh, no, we've been doing it. This for two seasons, and I'm starting to like know you, and I could read right through you. I'm just saying.
Damn it.
Damn.
All right, well, let's talk about this damn episode right here. We start off with Laurel and Jordan. That is not it. Laurel and Jordan being romantic, and everybody's talking shit, bananas, whatnot.
So he's number one, you're number two, you'd be number three, and I'm four.
See, this is what happens when I ask Nicolette to do technological. Mark, could you please turn my headphone volume
is this,
up?
Is this you?
I believe that
you?
Right, turn my volume right there.
No, no,
boom.
I know that was me.
So I know what's
mine's,
up.
Mine's super loud.
All right, should lower yours?
Yeah.
We're so on it now.
Right there? Yeah.
All right, good?
I know, we turned it down.
How about that?
No doubt.
Don't you worry about it.
Okay, about that.
Oh, yeah.
What kind of ship we running here?
We're back
Technical
to our regularly scheduled programming. That's why we're live, guys, and we know that you love us when we're live.
Boop.
On that note, let's talk about it. All right, so everyone's talking trash about Laurel and Jordan and Bananas.
Power couple.
He came out with
except for Cara Maria, who likes them. She seems to be the only one in the house.
Well, yeah, because they're best friends.
But Johnny in this hand comment.
We
got the second one.
The only thing mysterious about you is your four missing fingers.
If you haven't guessed yet, the guy has no filter.
Yeah.
He's one of my best friends.
The filter
is gone. You know when you're in a bar and you're like, oh my God, I hope he doesn't say that. He will say that and he'll say it loud and first.
But I don't know. See, I would always rather somebody who will say it out loud than somebody who will like look away. You know what I mean? I mean, there's a happy medium in there sometimes. But like if you have a hand, sometimes people try so hard not to look at it that it's like, I know what you're doing. So at least, I don't know. At least
the things, guys, just right. The guys, the things he wanted to do to Dustin on X's that wasn't allowed was unbelievably awesome. That I could never do, but it would fit so good if it was him.
I can't. Anywho, we get this Anissa and Teresa thing where Teresa is scared that Devin will vote her out. Well, you should be, bitch.
Yeah. Because
she made the remark, it was kind of low-key, low shade to Devin because she's like, I mean, she likes to eat, so you know, she might win.
It sounded like shade, but I think it was edited to sound like that.
Yeah, because I think she
Devin
meant she's
was
good
going
at these
around being like, yeah.
Oh yeah, well, I mean, still.
But still, in girls' yeah. world,
didn't best. Matter because that's not what the competition was.
Right.
Obviously,
Anissa kind of plays in fear, guys. She kind of plays in fear at all moments.
You know what's really funny is Anissa has. We have Steamer on the line. What up, Steamer?
No, I.
Is this?
Oh.
Wait a second,
Johnny Bananas.
I gotta give this guy a better intro than the Steam.
Yeah, I was gonna say, what's going on? Did you guys call me by an accident? Or what? I'm sitting here like, you know.
Wait, ladies and gentlemen of the AfterBuzz TV world, joining us now, one of my best friends, who really made a statement tonight, Mr. One and Only Bananas.
Several.
Wait, what? One of your best friends? Who do you got above ahead of me?
Come on, you're right up there in top. You know what? In the world of MTV, you're tops, dude. You're number one.
All right, thanks. All right, man.
In the world. What about outside of the world?
In all your years, Mark, you know what? The fact that I could sit at the top of that list means a lot to me.
There you go, buddy. So Johnny, I had them all confused because I was saying if you would have won, you would have been so happy to come in studio. So if you lost, you would only call in. So I had a few of the people here thinking you lost because you were only going to call in.
Yeah,
well, that's what we do, Mark. You know we can't give shit away, dude. So actually, people will try as hard as they can to ask you loaded questions and try and, you know, figure out in sneaky ways what actually happened. So I think the fact that you did that, I think that's a that is a tricky veteran move you pulled to just confuse everyone.
It was the bait and switch.
Okay, yeah. But if you had lost tonight, so if you had lost and we wanted you to call in anyway, would you have, or would you have been too embarrassed so you wouldn't have called us?
I wouldn't have been able to call because I would be in tomorrow's obituaries for opening my veins in the closet.
Fair enough. I'll
hey,
take it.
This is a high pressure episode for you tonight, Johnny. How? So listen, we've talked about this in the rivalry for a few weeks now. How nervous were you walking in the sand? He flips the three cards, you know, the hero move. Like, how, on a scale of 1 to 10, I mean, I know you're confident, but the nerves had to be up there as well.
For sure. Dude, there's high. The reason why is because there was so much riding on it. You right. never want to lose an elimination, ever. But if you lose, even if I would have lost to Isaac, it would have been like, listen, dude, there's two dudes just throwing. There was so much behind this.
Right.
And we had both. Like literally we both mortgaged our asses up to this point because we were both promising that we were going to send the other guy home. One of us was going to look like an asshole, and to have it happen, if it would have happened from him, it would have been that much bigger of a slap in the face. I mean, if I was to go up against, like, you know, Mark, for example, or even CT again or something like that, it's like these guys are tried and true. Veterans. They've earned the right to, you know, talk, you know, and they can walk the walk, whereas this guy, he hasn't proven anything, and he's said so much and he's cashed so many checks that his ass couldn't cash, you know, it would have just been that much bigger of a slap in the face. So yeah, dude, I mean, on a scale of 1 to 10, it was an 11, dude, as far as the anxiety is concerned.
Yeah, I mean, it was just crazy to really see him really, like, try to be so badass, and he really failed.
Wait, but if the situations were reversed, would you ever have gone and flipped every single card?
Never.
Or you just think that's moronic?
It's moronic. Okay, and Mark knows how this is. It's a crapshoot. You never know. I mean, even though it's a wall, and I think I'm pretty good at climbing, and you know I'm confident in my abilities. It's like you never know. That was drywall you're climbing up. You know, it's not a ladder. It could have broken.
Right.
I mean, there's a million things that could have went wrong. And the easiest, as even though it's not good for the viewers, the best game is when you don't go in, because then that just, you know, that just makes it that much more. That just takes that much more of a percentage out of the fact that you might get sent home on a, you know, something banky.
Right.
Well, Johnny, rewind it a little bit for us. You go into the house. Have you met Jordan before? Did you know of Jordan's personality?
Yeah, no, we did a challenge. We actually did the last challenge we did together was Rivals 2. It's his first challenge.
Boom.
And in all honesty, I mean, I never had a problem with the guy. If you rewind the footage, if you watch last season, I actually was kind of like, me and Frank were on a team. Frank hated him. And I'm like, dude, you know, this guy's all right. Like, it's his first one. He's trying to prove himself, like, whatever. But he developed this, like, overinflated self-ego in such a short amount of time. I guess what it is I just compared to the way that I came on shows, and everyone's always like, well, you were arrogant, you were cocky, too. It's like, I was loud. I was a loudmouth, and I was an asshole, but I was never arrogant, and I was never cocky. It was like, I walked into this house with all these veteran guys, and I'm like, shit, man, I got to prove myself. I'm not going to be, you know, talking above my pay grade yet. I'm going to let my performance speak for itself. Then once I developed, like, you know, kind of a track record and that I had proven myself, then it was like, you know, you kind of earn the right to say what you're going to say. But before this show, I mean, I really didn't have a problem with the guy.
So. And, you know, we've all kind of agreed that he kind of took the position of Wes in a way. Do you think it was kind of like an act he was putting up, or do you think he's just really that arrogant of a person?
I think it's a little bit of, both. I mean, there's, you don't know, we're all on this show for a reason, and it's all because we have something different about our personality. And I truly believe that Jordan is one of these guys that has an overinflated, like, vision of who he is and what, you know, who he is in the world and on these challenges, you know. And it's like, you gotta find your place, and I don't think he's found it yet. But I think what happened to him on this challenge from beginning to end hopefully is going to kind of give him a better idea.
Okay, so you guys clearly are rivals now. How would you feel if we do another Rivals and you get paired with him? Do you think you'll be able to work with him, or
my question?
Oh, that was a Twitter question.
That was a Twitter question. Don't answer it yet.
Kylie.
Okay, well, fine. It's from Kylie _190.
I've said this before, okay? When you go on these shows, your main purpose is winning. So I don't care. I'll put any bullshit aside that I have in order to win the money. As far as I'm concerned, you know, that's the ultimate goal. And it's like, if that's what had to happen. Could we work together? That's a different question. Would I go there and purposely sabotage our team? Absolutely not. I mean, you know, it's kind of like, I'm sure everyone in the workplace has someone that they don't like, but mm-hmm. when push comes to shove, in order for the betterment of, you know, the higher cause, you kind of have to put your own crap aside and do what you got to do.
What's the deal with just about Jordan still with the whole hand thing? I mean, you seem to be publicly talking about this hand thing all the time. Are you taking crap on Twitter and everywhere else? Listen, do you regret saying anything?
You know, okay. Here's the thing with that. I said a few things that I regret saying. Okay, what MTV likes to do is they like to find things and continue to harp on certain things. So I said a few things I probably shouldn't have said. Believe it or not, all the things that they've aired all came prior to me going into that elimination against Isaac, when I told him, yo, I'm going to rip your head off, or whatever it was. And when we got into that really big argument where basically we called each other out, the first thing I did was apologize for that. I said, listen, dude, the hand thing was out of line. You know, I didn't mean that. It was, you know, the heat of the moment. So
what did he say? What did he say?
What did he say about what?
Like, was he like, when, oh, it's apologize. All right, man.
Yeah, I mean,
he's, you know, obviously he's super confident, so that really doesn't seem like it bothers him.
The thing is that's not the type of person I am. That's not how I want to be known. You know, I mean, besides that, I mean, he's a good athlete. You know, you can't take that away from him. The guy's got endurance. It's just, that's not what his problem is. It's what he's got going on upstairs that he needs to work on a little bit.
Hey, Johnny. So. It's Mark. So the past two challenges, you've been thrown in.
It's Mark, in case you were wondering.
Well, you know what I'm saying.
Your best friend's voice sounds like.
I'm identifying with him.
I'm just kidding.
Johnny, the last two eliminations, you've had to kind of face the music. Is this foreshadowing? I mean, do you feel like you're kind of on an island now by yourself the rest of this challenge, or are we going to see some difference?
That's how I felt this entire show. I came into this show with literally no one. I mean, besides Leroy, who is a great guy, but as far as having him as in an alliance, having to rely on him to win or to save you or to be able to count votes to not have you go in, it didn't work out too good for me. So they haven't really played it up a whole lot, but basically at this point it was me on one side and Zach, CT, Johnny Riley, and Jordan all on the other side. So yeah, I was on an island, dude. I was like,
CT? What was CT doing on that other side?
Listen, we've done enough of these shows, me and CT, where it's like, listen, I don't want to see him there. He doesn't want to see me there. So anything he could do, because it's just going to make our lives that much more difficult when it gets to the end, when one of us is going to have to, you know, face the music. So anything. So obviously, I would have done the same thing. If Jordan would have run in his mouth, being like, "I'm going to go against CT," I would have been like, "Do it, Do yeah. it, man, because that's what you want. If someone is going to nominate themselves to go in, which you don't see happen very often, never. Especially against another power player, it's like either it's a win-win. Either way, one of these guys is going home, and it's just going to make my life that much easier.
Johnny, tonight we saw you kind of confront Laurel. As far as seeing Laurel getting close, I mean, I know you guys see relationships spark every season, but kind of seeing Laurel get closer to Jordan, you know, it kind of was irritating you. What was the most irritating part about that? Was it that she's a vet and maybe she's not getting her man in line, or just that you just couldn't stand Jordan and you're like, girl, what the hell are you doing?
Yeah.
Well,
this is they didn't show that conversation between me and her lasted a good 20 minutes, and they only showed a small part of it. What I told her, and when I said, listen, I don't think that his motives are kosher. Mm-hmm. Again, if you watch Rivals 2, day one, the first thing that he did is he went after the strongest girl in the house, who was Emily at the
time. That's crazy.
And made it a point to cozy up next to her. And it got to the point where they became so close. There was a few times, and I know Emily pretty well outside of the show, but I was like wondering, I'm like, Emily, I hope you haven't got your head lost in the clouds. Like, if push comes to shove, and if it comes down to me or him, I hope you have my back. And it was so he almost kind of fogged it up there. Then coming to this challenge, it was the exact same thing. I watched it like all over again. Day one, the first person he goes, he cuddles up with is the strongest girl in the house. And that's basically what I told her. I'm like, this is this guy's MO. Like, this isn't the first time he's done it. And here you are. It's like, I'm not going to say me and her are best friends. We know each other outside of the show. We've known each other for a while. And I was basically like telling her, like, listen, even despite the fact that we're our best friends, we're both veterans. We've both been here before. Like, how could you allow that, whatever this fake relationship you have, at least that's the way that I viewed it, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. cloud your judgment.
I mean, that makes a lot of sense.
Don't you think, though, that that could just be his type? Maybe he just likes a really competitive, strong girl, or you think that it's absolutely gameplay and there's nothing outside?
I have
outside.
No idea. I'm not a therapist. I can't look that deep into it. All I know is that on the surface, it just looked fishy. You know what I mean?
Well, like, from a girl's perspective.
My whole point was I've never had to rely on a girl in a game to better my position or have my back or whatever. You know, that's just never the way that I've played the game. And I was just basically telling her, like, listen, you weren't on Rivals. I saw what happened. And I was just basically trying to, let her know that, things might not be what they seem.
Well, and that he just walked away. He didn't even say bye to her. And she was like, ah, he didn't even say bye. Like, bitch.
Johnny, Mark Long, After Buzz TV. So listen, so now foreshadowing, and I know you can't talk about specifics, but so Jordan was your number one enemy. I mean, are you feeling a little more safe because he's gone, or are you just afraid these guys are going to line up and keep trying to pluck you off? I mean, can you rely on anyone?
I am. The only reason I'm not is because now everyone has seen, this is, I think, the most frustrating part about this whole thing. I've done up to this is my 10th challenge. In the previous 9 challenges, there were only 2 challenges that I ever did where I didn't see an elimination round. And
damn.
6 out of the other, 7, I was in the final elimination, which is the most difficult one.
Right.
So coming to this game, it's like everyone had amnesia. And they're like, oh yeah, Bananas hasn't seen an elimination round since 1998. I'm like, what have you guys been? I mean, I've been in an elimination round practically every challenge I've been on. So for people then to come in and be like, oh, we didn't know if he still had it, or we thought he lost it or whatever, coming into this one, going in twice, dominating both elimination rounds that I did, I think it put a lot of the guys on notice, like, okay, if we keep sending him in, he's going to keep coming back. This probably isn't the smartest move.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So I didn't know. Going forward from here, I knew Jordan was obviously the biggest hurdle for me. But with him being gone, I didn't know. I mean, there are other guys in the house that hadn't even seen an elimination round yet. So I was just hoping that I had proven myself. I'd done what I had to do, and I wasn't going to continue to be thrown in. But you never know.
Well, let me read this Twitter question since you said that. So would you say that it would be Jordan? Lauren _ Marini asks, who is your biggest threat on free agents?
My biggest threat?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, it depends on as far as what. I mean,
Overall, it could be like, mental. It could be politics.
Okay, obviously, you know, going me and CT's rivalry, you know, started on my first challenge I ever did, going back to the beginning of time. And I know that there are certain things that if it came down to it, I mean, you want to talk about a long day at the office. I mean, facing CT and anything physical would be an absolute nightmare. In addition to that, I mean, the guy plays an absolutely savage political game. So, you know, CT, obviously, every time coming into these games is probably my biggest hurdle. He's played – some of these other guys might be strong in certain areas, but CT is the most well-rounded player there.
Do you respect his game?
Do I respect his game? I mean, it's a different game than I play. I got to respect him for actually being able to make it work. There's no way that if I played the game the way that he did, that it would work for me. So, yeah, I got to respect the fact that, you know, he plays it, and I think he's the only one that could play that game and actually have it work very well.
With all the challenges that you've been in, before we get into tonight's episode, I have to ask, what is one of your favorite obstacles that you've had to do? What was one of the favorite challenges that you just can go back and just be like
team, like we're talking about like team challenges or like the finals?
It could be
either. Something that you're like, wow.
I think
Mark was actually here for this one. I think the one where we had to run behind that Learjet and the engines were like throttled up.
And people were getting flown.
Dude, that was, do you remember how gassed out we were at the end of that thing?
Dude, gassed out. I mean, you want to talk about, the thing with most challenges is it's like usually you've experienced being high before. You've experienced being underwater before. You've experienced so many things. No one knows what it feels like to run behind a friggin' jet engine that's like throttled up and like blown like, you know, gale force 1,000-degree winds in your face, and not only having to run through it, but then grabbing a parachute and having to run directly into it.
That was great.
I remember when one of the floaties went all the way.
Oh, yeah. Okay, so tonight's challenge, you guys get wrapped up in Saran wrap, and you have to roll yourself through this grill obstacle course. What was it like? You come up to the event. Obviously, you've done so many of these, so you know it looks easy, but it sure ain't. What was your strategy before, or while you were watching the girls?
Let me just say that out of everything we've ever done, this was on like a comfort level. This was hands down the most horrible thing they've ever like had us do, as far as like the way it felt.
Wow.
And I unfortunately, I mean, they didn't show this part, but there was at this point, I think 10 guys left, and we had to each be wrapped individually. For each guy to be wrapped, I mean, they unrolled, you know, 4 rolls of Saran wrap on each guy to make it so you really couldn't move.
Wow.
And I was the first guy wrapped up. I was wrapped up, I had to lay down in the sand in the blazing hot sun and just sit in this plastic and sweat for probably an hour, because each guy took at least, you know, 10 minutes to get wrapped up.
We don't
up.
Think about all of that.
So, oh my God. And then once we got started, I mean, the first, that initial sprint, that roll we had to do was 100 yards. So we basically rolled the length of a football field, then turned around, then rolled over that cattle guard, and then rolled around another corner, went through tomatoes and wet grass and over seashells. So by the end of it, not only are you like sweaty, and not only can you not move, but you're just full of like sand and tomatoes and grass and seashells.
Was the grill really hot, or was it not?
No, it wasn't. No, they just made it. That was like dry ice. They were trying to make it look like it was hot. It wasn't hot. It was really. Now I know why cows don't want to walk over those things. I mean, I never want to roll over one of those again. So.
Was Zach being a little baby when he got to the end and like ripped it all off, or is that how you all felt? Were you all just like?
I mean, that's how we all. Here's the thing. One of the most anxiety, invoking feelings is not being able to move.
Yeah.
And they have you wrapped up with your arms and your body and your and your legs and everything. They have you wrapped so tight, you can't move. So
my brother jumped on me.
It was so horrible, dude. I mean, that was the actual challenge. So we all kind of felt the same way Zach did at the end. It was like, because then you're done and you're lying on this friggin' bun and it's like, okay, get me out of this now. The challenge is over, you know, and you're still waiting for these other idiots to roll up. So.
Right. Literally roll up.
My brother jumped on me when I was little on a beanbag and held me. And I to this day, I probably would have freaked out like Zach. I don't like
being reptilian. Ever since I've been a kid, it's like I've seen like these movies where people get like locked and buried alive in a coffin. And I'm like, I can't imagine anything that would be more, that would be worse than being trapped in a box where you can't move, you know, and that's kind of like what this mimicked, dude, was the fact that, like, you know, you're wrapped so tight and, you know, you couldn't move any part of your body. It was horrible.
Do you guys remember the challenge where I think it was Jasmine, she was locked in a case and then underneath hay, yeah, and who had to
under the grass, yeah.
That always sticks out to me as like, what the fuck? Y'all did what?
And she was in there for a long time too. You had to wait for she was in there for a couple hours.
Oh no.
So Johnny, you gave us an opinion on the guys. Who do you think? I mean, I know Laurel's like the head dog right now, but are there any sleepers you think for the girls? Like, who do you think is going to be sliding through?
I mean, all the standouts are pretty much. Jessica actually has surprised a lot of people that she's made it as far as she has with, you know, as non-conventional a game as she's played, where she's kind of just walking the beat of her own drum. You know, usually at this point people fall in line and she's kind of still like, I'm playing my own game.
Right.
But I mean, Devin's another one, dude. She's a smart girl, dude. She might not be the most spry and athletic, but she's intelligent, and you know as well as I do that if you're smart in these games, I mean, that's almost as good, if not better, than being physically fit.
So we're talking about the women right now, and I just wanted to go for another Twitter question. Autumn Kleins wants to know, why doesn't Johnny and Cara Maria get along? What's the backstory on that?
Oh, man, I don't know, dude. I mean, there's some things that went on outside of challenges that where she kind of interfered in my personal life with some relationships that I had that, you know, we don't really need to go into details with that, but it really has nothing to do with the show. Like I said, it has to do with some old things that happened out off the show. But I mean, since then, they're making things look a lot more adversarial on this season than they really were. I mean, you know, we were much more mortal enemies last season. Season kind of let bygones be bygones. So
I was gonna say, it almost like when she said, oh, I can't wait to throw Johnny, it's almost like she did it just, it was like you guys really did get along, but she just did it from past stuff that she like just drummed up out of nowhere.
I mean, that's where we are at this point, where it's like, listen, like, we obviously aren't working together. You're doing your thing, I'm on this other side. I don't hate you, I don't wish you, you know, ill will, but at the same time, we're not working together. And when my name came out that first time, that's what I said. I was like, you know, it's about time. Like, I can't believe it took you this long to throw my name out there, you know?
Well, so with Laurel...
And just so everyone knows, I mean, I don't know, rewind the Twitter, my Twitter. I wished her a happy birthday a week and a half or 2 weeks ago. So,
oh, see, Johnny, that. You're full of joy good tonight. Guy.
I know, man.
So
I love it.
Laurel has this thing with Anissa. She feels like Anissa is playing this best friend game. Can you kind of speak on that as far as Anissa being in the house and what her strategy is? And is it a smart strategy? Because tonight she looked crazy to me. Like she looked.
Well, Mark knows this about everyone has to play to their strengths. Some people have certain strategies that are different than other people's. And Anissa always plays the same strategy, which is she kind of wants to be on everyone's good side. You know what I mean? Which is fine. But at the same time, it's like, after a while, then that starts to look to other people like, hey, if you're best friends with this person and this person is against, what are you saying to them about me? You know what I mean? So it gets really murky. Mm-hmm. You can't, and I've noticed this, and which is why, I mean, I've been called out for so many things in the past, dude. Oh, I've done this, I'm a scumbag, blah, blah. I'm to the person, though, where it's like 9 times out of 10 people know where they stand with me. And if we're working together, they know that. If we're not, then we're not. I don't.
Would you agree, Mark? Is that true?
Well, and Johnny, you'll agree with this. Anissa plays in, she kind of plays in like a fear game. Like she's always plays in fear. And you know how we've always said, like, when I show up or when you show up, we're not playing, hey, I hope we make it another week. We just assume because we're just trying to be confident and kind of pump ourselves up. We assume we're going to be there till the end. She's always a play till the next week kind of person. You know, like,
I'm happy to be here plan.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So she plays in fear and she kind of two sides. I mean, even when she was with Rachel and you and I were down there in Dominican Republic, she pulled a little shenanigans. But, I mean, it's just her strategy, I guess.
And that's what it is. People have the political game is so important. I mean, it really is so important. And in all my years and everything I've done, I still haven't even mastered the political game because it's like I'll come into houses and even if I'm trying to be, I'm not even trying to be nice to everyone. I'm just trying not to make any waves. And somehow, even me going in, not intentionally making any waves, somehow I make waves. So I'm kind of resigned to the fact that no matter how I play, I'm going to rub someone the wrong way. So, you know, I kind of have who I know outside of the show. I go in 9 times out of 10 kind of with already my alliance or who I'm working with or whatever set in place. And I don't, once I'm there, if I meet people, I don't try and establish new connections or new friendships or anything like that because it usually never works out. And, you know, like I said, people, I've been accused of being a lot of things on these shows, but never, I'm not a person that's going to run around and, you know, make all these promises to everyone and fill people's head with a, you know, false hope. So
where did you stand with Laurel in that case? Because like we're talking about, you know, and you guys get that.
I honestly don't know where me and Laurel stand, to be honest.
And if you guys were going to go on a show together again, would you have to have a conversation before the show with her? Like what's the deal?
Absolutely. I mean, that's the thing. It's, I'm the type of person where it's like, unless something changes in our relationship, then I'm kind of under the impression that we're kind of where we were. Right. And the that fact that it was like coming to this show, I mean, she hasn't done a challenge in a while outside of the show. You know, I consider us, you know, friends, and to come into this show and then for her to then start, you know, hooking up with someone that was then at this point in the game, my mortal enemy.
Right.
And on this show, when she voted me in, I was really kind of shocked, dude. I mean, they didn't really show it, but I was kind of like, dude, that's pretty weird. Because, I mean, that's my thing is with her. It's like, I got no qualms against you. Why create new enemies, especially people who are strong, you know, players in the house? So for her to kind of, you know, throw that vote out there for me was kind of perplexing.
How did you feel about your game plan when you went in and found out it was free agents? And then when they threw the draw on you guys, what was going on in your head?
I think, hey, John, talk about that when you called me. You're like, Mark, you have no idea. This was the worst time ever. I was nervous 24 hours. Everyone was nervous 24 hours a day. Talk about that.
Dude, the thing about challenges is like the formats are never – they're not meant to like give you – to provide you with any comfort or any ease. You know, the way they format it, the way the voting is, it's always like, you know, am I going to get called out today? But usually the format is the same in the fact that it's usually, you know, today's a guy day, you know, then, you know, 2 days from now it'll be the girl day. So as long as you make it through the guy day, you know that until the next guy day, which is usually the following week, you're set.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas on this one, the way they had it set up is, there was no girl day, guy day, and any day could be you could have your number pull. And it wasn't, what was weird about this one, it was almost like there was like a disincentive to win,
right?
Or not to win, but to come in second. It was almost like in some cases you'd rather come in the bottom four than come in not first, because then you at least know you're going to the draw and you had a 25% chance as opposed to a, you know, 50%, 70%, 100% chance of going in.
Right, so that's what we saw with Leroy tonight, where
they took that little bit of comfort that you have in normal challenges, where it's like, okay, I made it through the guy's day, I'm good till next week. That was gone. So any day could be your day, and so you had to bring it every day, and it was, you never had that opportunity to like let your brain like relax, and it was anxiety. You know, 24/7. And then the draw sucked, because then if you get nominated to go in, you've got 24 hours to kind of prepare yourself mentally for whatever you're going to get involved in. With the draw, you have, if you flip that kill card over, you've got 5 minutes you know, to prepare to, you know, to go and face someone who's had all day to prepare, you know. So
did you drink, hey, did you even if you were going in the draw, you didn't know you were going in, did you prepare any of your crazy psycho energy drinks?
Oh yeah.
That was the best. Our concoctions we used to make. We used to give the girls, and they would just be spazzing out. They'd never.
Wait,
done
you
it.
Make them from what ingredients?
Oh, like no, like we'd have like NO Explode, and then Red Bull, and like just crazy stuff. And I remember giving, we gave one to someone. I don't know if it was DM or whatnot. She just like almost had a meltdown.
It was hilarious. Dude, I mean, that stuff, because that if you take too much of that stuff, then it actually it mimics adrenaline, so it'll give you like this crazy anxiety attack. So if you take too much of it, not only have anxiety that you're going in. Then it's like you take, you know, whatever this crazy, you know, potion is, dude. Then on top of that, it just makes it magnifies that much more. Isn't that
helpful? Okay, I want to ask you a little bit. This is kind of random, but I'm asking you about the other Johnny because I need some insider information here. When we watched his season of the... What do you mean?
I'm just kidding.
Oh, Boston, represent. When we watched a season in the real world, he was kind of goofy and didn't seem like he'd be somebody who'd do well on the challenge. Tonight we saw him win and I was really shocked. It looks like he's really shaped up. What kind of a competitor is he, and do you guys have any relationship at all?
Johnny's a sleeper. Most of the times you come to these challenges, you get the guys pretty well sized up. Johnny just has this ability. I mean, he was just, I almost, toward, you know, as the show progresses, me and our relationship kind of, you know, changes as far as like, you know, we go from being adversarial to just being like, all right, dude, now it's, you know, kind of like the hate's out of it. Now it's like, we're just competing against each other.
Mm-hmm.
But once it was weird, once Jordan left, it was like, then I finally was able to kind of like get to know him a little bit better. Cause I think him and Jordan being as close as they were, it was almost like, you know, they're really good friends. And it's like, yo, this dude, Bannis is my mortal enemy, you know, kind of stay away from him type of thing. But, He is a true sleeper, and he plays the game right. And I actually told him this. I hope they show this on an episode. I don't know if they do, but I told him, I'm like, listen, dude, you play this game the right way. You know your role. Huh. You keep your ears open, your eyes open, and your mouth shut. You show up, you compete, and you allow, you know, your performance to speak for itself. And it's funny because even though Johnny had voted me in twice, and even though I voted him in once, it was like, I felt no sense of animosity towards him, and not the way that I felt about Jordan, because, and again, they didn't show this either, but before both times that he voted me in, we had a conversation. He pulled me aside and he's like, listen, dude, you know, no hard feelings, but my vote's going to be for you. And I respect that. I respect when people do that. And, you know, on top of the fact that he's a good competitor, he plays, you know, in my opinion, he plays a straight up game. And, you know, that's probably the biggest compliment you give someone in one of these shows.
Absolutely. Cool. As a real throwback, so just to get through some of these Twitter questions, @IcedC of New York wants to know, how did the name Johnny Bananas come about?
Well, that's an easy question. I think after you watch tonight's episode, it'll answer itself. They call me Bananas because I could climb like a motherfucker.
So out of all the...
Like a monkey.
The challenges, this was probably one the better ones. Were you happy when you saw the wall, like as far as the
it depends on who you're gonna go in.
Well, tonight you versus Jordan.
You look at the way I would have gone up against him in anything, dude. In all honesty, I'm pretty confident that I could have beat him in any of the elimination rounds that were there.
But
that's because me and him, as far as like stature is concerned, we're similar in stature, whereas some of these challenges relied purely on weight and purely on, you know, just size. And I mean, you don't need to be a genius to look at some of these and know that it's like I'd have a lot easier time pulling a guy like Jordan to the sand than I would someone like Zach or CT. So I felt comfortable in that one. You know, and
Where do you stand with Jordan out? I mean, do you guys do any Twitter beefs?
I don't know, dude. Where do I stand? I doesn't exist to me, dude.
So do you got no Twitter jabs or back and forth?
You know what? The way I see it is like I don't need to waste. I got enough going on I started my own website and I got some other, you know, merchandise and that sort of thing. I'm trying to, on these shows, I'm just trying to, you know, keep it as kind of like as jovial and as positive as I can on my own front. And I got enough going on then to be worrying about what he's you know, piping off on about.
One last question before we get into some of the stuff that you have going on. But TJ, he always seems to, you know, he really excited when, you know, you guys do perform really well. He loves Cara Maria, just seeing her fucking grow. But tonight it seemed like he was a little mad at Jordan. Kind of like, oh, well, you blew all this money. And then told him that he got served. It seemed like he was a little angry with Jordan. Was he mad at Jordan for being cocky?
He has favorites, is what we think. We think he has his favorites, and he shows them on the show.
What it is, it's not even necessarily, because believe it or not, I was never one of TJ's. I was never one of production's favorites in general. Okay, mm-hmm. And there were so many times that I know production wanted more than anything to not see me perform well, just because I'm a lot to deal with in the house.
Mm-hmm. I can second
but,
that.
I mean, obviously, I mean, TJ, he's like the 29th cast member in a way, and he knows everything that's going on in the house, and he's a fan and a viewer just like everyone else. So that's the thing, is if you're even rubbing the host the wrong way, and I mean that was pretty obvious by you know what he said.
Right.
I mean that's you know saying something. But at the same time, how could you not? Anyone I think in a way would be upset where it's like, listen, the way you did it, it's not the fact that you did it. If you want to go in and you want to take out one of the top guys and you want to, you know, more power to you. But show a little humility while you're doing it. And I think that's the thing that rubbed everyone the wrong way. Mm-hmm. It wasn't the fact that Jordan, you know, wanted to prove himself or that he, you know, has this thing where he wants to come on and be a good competitor. I mean, more power to you. It's the way in which you go about doing it. It's just really hard for someone, especially someone like TJ, who is, you know, probably one of the most competitive people on the face of the planet,
right,
to, you know, see something like that and to agree with it, you know.
One of Jordan's final comments tonight was, 110% my pride and character is worth $125,000. How do you feel about that? Do you agree, disagree?
That doesn't make any, that, to it me, doesn't that doesn't make sense. Any, that's a backwards, that makes no sense. So, If it was worth $125,000, then you shouldn't have done it, because by doing that, you just shot all your pride and everything right out the window.
You're bankrupt.
Yeah.
You done lost money.
The whole point of the reason why you did that was because you have your pride, you know, comes
is a
before
problem.
even logical decisions you're going to make. So it wasn't. Obviously, the money, you know, wasn't worth it.
The bulldog and the chihuahua.
Well, there you go. All right,
Bananas. Spoken like a true poet.
Bananas, tell us about your website and what you have for sale. What do you have going
on?
Yeah.
Well, it's about time. I've been kind of working on this for a while. So I created my own website. I feel like, you know, it's only the appropriate thing to do after this long of being on television. So the website is realjohnnybananas.com. And it's just got anything that a challenge lover, you know, it's kind of like a challenge lover's wet dream. I mean, it's got, you know, pictures and videos of past cast members, past challenges. I got a virtual tour of the free agent's house. And then also got, all my merchandise that I'm selling on there. I got, trucker hats. I got girls booty shorts coming in soon. T-shirts, and then the pièce de résistance, the Johnny Bobblehead. So
what's the biggest seller so far, Johnny? Is it the bobblehead?
I want the bobblehead.
The bobblehead is the tried and true seller, dude. I mean,
can we get a bobblehead for the studio here?
We need some booty shorts and a bobblehead.
Yes, we really need
one
here.
Because we would put it every episode.
As long as you guys take them to really weird places and take pictures of them doing really weird things, you guys can have a bobblehead.
We want a bobblehead for the studio.
That's not a problem.
Yeah. I'll put a whole care package to you guys. I just got a box from China just showed up at my house today. It's got like
awesome.
200
I'll give you an address later and send it. We'll display it every week up on the desk.
Yeah, absolutely, man. You got it.
Hey, so it's realjohnnybananas.com.
Realjohnnybananas.com, and that's on the World Wide Web.
And then your Twitter?
Twitter is MTVBananas, and Instagram is also realjohnnybananas.
And Roxy wanted one last question. I don't even know if you know this.
No, it has nothing to do with you. It's just something I've been curious about John A's AB on the side of her face. What is the AB? Do you know what I'm talking about when she goes to compete?
I think that's so she can remember her blood type. I have no idea, dude.
Okay. What a weird way to end this interview. Yep.
Hey, thanks for calling in, my man.
Thank you for calling in.
She actually writes her name on the other side of her face, so she can remember that, too.
We're going to have you come in studio one of these days on a less traffic-y day.
I will, man, for sure. Yeah, I'll make a note of it. I'll drive up the night before. That way, I can miss awful Southern California.
Exactly.
Shock with Mark.
You can stay at Mark's house.
Yeah, and Johnny, we're gonna. I'll send you this link tomorrow, so you can tweet, but you can see the full thing on the link we sent you.
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely. And send me that address too, so I can give you guys some banana swag.
For sure.
All right. Thank you.
All right. Thanks,
man.
Thanks
for coming in, Johnny.
All right.
On that note, let's head.
Thanks for the interview, guys.
See you, buddy.
Into predictions.
And now,
Suck Ya Fight Club TV
predictions. Guys, Nani's being a little bit of a slur here.
What?
With the Cahuta and the Johnny.
Three's Company.
That's the alcohol talking.
I mean, Johnny's convinced that she's really into him. It seems to me like she's way more into Cahuta.
Definitely, but I don't know.
And Nani likes her Boston boys, Cahuta, remember her season.
Cahuta, every time she goes, he keeps calling her my girl. He's like, oh, my girl's doing so well. Oh,
yeah,
girl.
I'm interested to see what's going to happen next
I
week.
I think the thing is Cahuta might be too nice for her.
Yeah, honestly, totally.
You know, she seems like she likes
her. Did she get with Leroy for a while, too? Or did that not?
Yeah, she made out with Leroy, or they had sex.
Because she was with Adam from her season.
No, not then. It was last season that we last chat, whatever.
I don't know. I just feel like Johnny and her make more sense. Cahuta is too smart for her.
Oh, I thought I said too nice.
He's too nice, but he's also too smart for her.
Cahuta's like we love him. We love him.
Cahuta's great.
Yeah, he's
a dog. Cahuta's a good time on TV. Yeah. I'm glad they bought him back.
Yeah,
he's
absolutely.
Fun.
And guys, we see the challenges. Hold that pose.
Yeah.
What do we think about that?
That looks painful. Cool.
Strike a pose.
I don't know if
that looks cool.
I still want the competitor in me. I still want to see CT go against Zach head to head. I don't know if that's even going to happen in my dreams of challenge
but
dreams.
But you know what it would be? I'd want to see the one that John did last week where they would have to get
ball
the ball in the,
with the football pay. Yeah, that'd be a great one. God, that's my wish. That's hopefully my prediction.
Well, maybe because at the end we see CT say, snipe. See you later.
Oh, man. It's gonna be good. You guys, you guys sucked in.
I'm sucked in.
Yeah, it's a good season.
The free agents is like a whole nother level.
Yeah. Yes. Like, I feel like I live at the house.
Yeah, right?
Yeah, definitely.
Wait till we get the banana swag.
I know, I'm excited.
I'm really
excited.
We'll
have him.
Oh. We're going to have these guys in some
booty
shorts.
I'll bring it in, you guys.
We'll be in our booty shorts.
Without drinking our pocket protein.
There you go.
There you guys go. Make sure you guys hit us up at AfterBuzz TV. Thanks for tuning in. Also, hit us up on iTunes. Tweet me at DJ Jesse J.
Me at Since They Don't Play.
Me at The Mark Long.
At Roxy Striar.
Until next week, same time, same place. Peace.
Peace.
From executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Buzz you later.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.
Thank you for watching AfterBuzz TV on YouTube. For more of your favorite after shows and interviews, subscribe to our channel here and be sure to share your opinion on the episode in the comment section below here. We'd love to see what you guys are buzzing about. Thanks again. Buzz you later.